were working.
Now it works.
Yes. Thank you so much for being here.
Thanks for me to that I could come here.
Yes. I mean, I think we're going to talk about a lot of things. In particular, you know, some of your very specific work on specific shows, but also just your career path. And I think that might be really interesting, especially to the Estonian writers in the room, who the industry might work slightly differently here. Maybe they can learn some tips from how you've navigated this world. And yes, so we'll talk about quite a few things.
May I start to say something?
Of
because
course.
I think it was really interesting to see all this brave new world of what's actually going on now. And what I think is important as a writer or anyone, you have to orientate you in this to really see what's going on, because there's so much things happening right now. So you have to some kind of not be too narrow-minded about yourself, but really look into what's going on and where you can place yourself in that and make partnerships. And then I would want to say one other thing, because when we all saw all these clips of shows, they look fantastic, but when we see the shows, maybe some of them are really good, but some of them also fell down somehow. And what is important to when you make this serious and make this go into this, is always try to make good quality. Always. There's different kind of genres, there's different kind of trends, and all it's changed all the way, and you have to go into that. But when you are into and get the permission to make a show or be part of a show, think of the quality to be as high as possible, because then you are a winner. Because when you slow the quality and try to just to go just to make it okay or proper, then there's a big risk that it can actually collapse.
Yeah. So don't just churn it out. You need every episode has to be good.
Yeah. And the show and the premise and everything has to be really clever thinking about. That's I think that's a key thing.
Yeah, I wanted to go right back to after you graduated from film school, and how did you start to get work, and what kind of work were you doing immediately then? And
I can tell it. I'm 58, so it actually 30 years ago I went out of film school. So I had so it's a long career.
The industry, there was no Netflix then.
No. And it was really interesting in Denmark at that time, because in the late 80s, beginning of the 90s, Denmark was in some kind of quite big, both economical and also cultural crisis, and the media was in some kind of crisis, because somehow the level of people going to see Danish film was low, and see Danish TV shows was really low. And and so when I went out from the film school, I went out to a world where the possibilities to work was really low. Actually, and that was what was part of our generation coming up from the film school in the late 90s, early 90s. But we had a vision, you can say, because we have somehow seen the future in some kind of way, you can say. But we have seen that we wanted this generation who came out from the film school at that time, we wanted to change the media, and both films and also television. We wanted to go into and make some changes, and somehow within quite a long period of years it actually happened.
And what would you say those changes you were trying to make, to maybe make things more character driven, or what did you want to shake up?
Yeah, so simply to get some work, because there was made no TV shows, and there was only made 8 films every year. There was only made 8 feature films, and the old generation, who was quite strong and also quite prophetic, they sat on these 8. So
and
as
they were
a
quite
young
classical
generation, yeah, it was historic dramas. It was Bille August and Søren Krav Jacobsen who made big historical dramas and book adaptations of classical Danish literature. And so we had to really rethink about what should we do, and out of that dogma yeah. came out, and a new realism, as scripted drama, but with not going to look at books, but original scripted drama and authentic and now showing stories that happens right now and not in the in the past. So that was part of that, and then also of course looking at how could we change the medium of television in a more interesting way.
And did you know when you went to school whether you wanted to do more film or more TV? I guess, you know, going into TV in Denmark at that time, you didn't have examples of great,
no,
exciting TV.
Yeah, we had one actually quite popular series called Matador. I think it's maybe also shown in these regions because it's some kind of a classic and it's actually quite good. But at that time there was no but that was 15 years ago when I went out for the film school, and when I was at the film school and my generation, we was not at all into television. I'm out of the 80s, so it was French film, it was Truffaut, it was Fassbender, it was what's happening in art cinema and in American cinema in the 70s, we thought was the interesting things to do. We think that Danish film at that time, these historical period dramas, was boring. We called it straw hat films because every male character had some kind of straw hat on him. And but then in the early 90s, something happened that really changed. Two things happened actually, that really changed things in Denmark regarding television. It was that the showing of Twin Peaks. When Twin Peaks came in the early start of the 90s, it was the first time that the young generation at that time felt, also the young movie generation that felt, wow, this is a television series who talked to us.
Yeah.
Who simply says this is not some kind of crime show. It's not. It had a cult flavor. Mm-hmm. It has some ironic. It has some really early 90s flavor to it that really talked to our generation. And really in Denmark, it really changed things because suddenly quite a talentful, quite broad generation wanted to say, wow, there's something interesting going on in television.
That wouldn't have been a hit for everybody in Denmark, but for artistic types, it was sort of
it was quite a big hit, actually. It was because at that time there was only two channels in Denmark. So if there was something of quality about quality, then actually people. So it was in Denmark, for example, Twin Peaks was kind of phenomenon, also in a much broader way than maybe in America.
Okay. In America, it was so cult.
Yeah.
But I remember that same feeling of oh my gosh, this isn't. My parents aren't watching this, and this is exciting.
Yeah. That's really good and fun and a lot of really interesting qualities to it. And then the other thing, what happened in Denmark right at that time was that that before that, in the 80s, we had only one channel. One public broadcaster. We had no commercial television at all, and it was part of the Nordic broadcaster tradition not to have commercial television. There was a law against it, but then the satellites came, and then you could make commercial television from London and send to satellites and every like some of these now changes with streaming actually happened in the late 80s about satellite television and later on also cable television. And then suddenly you could see that you couldn't keep up this monopole of public broadcasters. You had to allow commercial television. And what happened in Denmark was that they made a commercial television station called TV2 who started up in the late 80s, and they got all the viewers simply overnight. Everyone, because everyone think that the Danish radio, the big public broadcaster, was boring and old-fashioned, so they went to the new one, and they also at this television TV2 took all the young program makers and all the young people for DR and just gave them a job over there. So in a 1 year or two, they had the biggest market share. And then you should think, oh, wow, that's good also for television drama. It was not so good because they were only into game shows, sports, and they invented female handball. So female handball got quite popular, and everybody was looking at female handball and game shows and talk shows. And then the old station, this old gray-haired public service station, DR, had to reinvent themselves and say, what, oh, the other stations had all these shows and all this, we can't do that, what should we do? Maybe we should make drama. Maybe they looked at they looked over at America and American television, and you could say, okay, there's actually some quite good shows over there, like NYPD Blue, and also, of course, Twin Peaks, and maybe we should try to do that at the same. So DR, in reinventing themselves, they actually started in the late, in the early 90s, they started this television boom we had in Denmark. It started there in the early 90s, mid 90s. And I think it's quite interesting that it's not because of some vision that, oh, we are going to make this. It was because of a crisis.
It was a competition.
Yeah, we have really had to, shit, we have our walls at our back. We have to invent something new. And in that process, you take chances. You don't go for the safe. You actually go for also some kind of, you take chances. And what they did at that time, and what I also was a part of that I think was really interesting, was that before that, drama on television at the old times in DR, it was theater people making what you should television plays. So you invited theater writers to make some kind of a one-hour play, and then a theater director made it in studio, and you made some kind of genre. Who was everybody in Scandinavia knows how popular it was or unpopular it was, because that's what somehow and the public service broadcaster think they was trying to educate the audience going to more to look at drama as some kind of theater play. And what did DR find out when they started to want to reinvent themselves in the early 90s was to, when they looked both to America, but also to Sweden, who had done that in a couple of years before, it was to invite film people. Say, if we're going to have some kind of TV shows or TV series who are actually
film
popular.
Writers,
so
film
writers, film directors, film photographers, and not some kind of all this field as a TV photographers who make news the one day sports, another day, and then the third day they made a TV theater play. That was the situation in Denmark. That was quite old-fashioned. So to invite the film community into to be part of creating television shows, and I was part of that first wave.
Okay. So yeah, what was the first DR show that you worked on?
I worked at a show called Taxa, so that was a way of where we in Denmark tried to make some kind of Danish NYPD Blue, not with police, not with cops, but with taxi drivers, having some kind of story in every, we had a taxi central, and then we had a couple of taxi drivers who had, who was driving out and showing their private life and conflicts between each other, and also stories when they were driving taxi, and that was the first show I was a part of, and actually the first show to try to implement this American way of making 20 episodes of high quality drama a year.
Yeah, I still hear about it as being quite influential.
Yeah, and it was, and that was also it when it started up the expectations. Before that, also Lars von Trier had made The Kingdom.
Oh, yeah.
And it was also with the inspiration of it was made also out of the inspiration of Twin Peaks.
Yeah.
Could we make some kind of Danish kind of show, Twin Peaks? And then Lars von Trier made this show, who was actually really cheap. So the financing of it was really cheap. So it was really and they did a lot of things to make it. To make it, give it a quality, truth that it was quite cheap produced. They worked with two cameras. The work with all thing was in yellow because then you don't have to work with light, but you could filter it afterwards in the editing. So you gave it a yellow tone to everything and taking out the colors. Then you could you didn't have to have light on the set, and you could produce a lot of minutes every day. So they invented a lot of cheap ways that they have learned from Homicide, because that was how Homicide were produced, with the yellow light. So that's
Lars von Trier and Homicide. I didn't know.
Yeah, so they analyzed Homicide when they was making the Kingdom. But Taxa was then the second one, but still at that time the expectations of Danish drama on television was quite low. So when it started to be shown, it has really low figures because there was
people weren't used to watching something like that.
Simply wasn't used. They saw American shows, and English shows. So it started quite low, 400,000. But every it was produced in a 3 years time. There was produced around 56 episodes, and when the first episodes was shown, it was around 400,000. And but for every other episodes, it's the height with 20,000 to 30,000. So when the last episode was shown, 2 million people in Denmark saw it, half the population, and everybody, as the streets were empty, and everybody was really into it. And after that, you can say success. You had some quite a level, and then the other show who came afterwards, Unit One. Always stayed at 2 million.
Okay, so that sort of built that audience.
Some kind of built up that audience, and also the self, you could say the knowledge of how to make television series in DR at that time, and also some kind of self respect. So you actually, as of you invented, as yours, you told, it was only for the local market. We had no intentions of, it was about saving television in Denmark, actually, to try to create something new. And then suddenly we said, they also want to see it in Sweden and Norway, and it became quite popular. And it was the first time a Danish television series was popular in Sweden, because the Swedes looked at Danish as some kind of little brother who can't do anything, and they have Bergman, and Bergman had made all this stuff, and suddenly there came some kind of shows that was that was actually quite popular in and then it took afterwards, it was also exported to a great deal, great parts of Europe, except the big countries.
But then the big countries would come in for The Bridge, which is a show I want to talk about partly because I love it.
Yeah.
I know there'll be a lot of fans in this room. I mean, can you talk about the genesis of that show, how you came on board? Were you a sort of writer for hire? Had you been one of the originators of the idea, or how did that come about for you?
I came into it, it's around that time I had been working with television, also writing feature films for around 10 years. And I have both been an episode writer, or a writer who was in part of the creators group of both the Taxa and Unit One. And also later on, I was the creator of some other TV series. But I got an offer to I had a good friend who just started up in a company called Nimbus Film, and who was actually the producer of the Feast. It's Festen. What's it called in English?
The Celebration. Festen, Thomas Vinterberg.
That was really popular and a big Cannes hit. And but they have never done television at that time. And then now they got a new CEO, and it was a good friend of mine. And we talked about it's right now that this company Nimbus should go into television, because you could feel that there was something cooking around that's the genre of the future. We have a lot of people who were thinking about, and then they got an offer from Sweden that a company called Filmlands, who was Stockholm based, they had tried to develop a series in Stockholm together with SVT that at that time was called Morgenstjerne, that was about could you make a crime story in Malmö and Copenhagen, and somehow use the bridge, the Öresund bridge, as some kind of metaphor for it. And but they have somehow they've gone to develop in hell, and of the three original creators, two had left the project, so they needed some new energy, and they actually got the last chance from SVT in Sweden to try to could this project come back on track somehow. And then this company, and I think it is quite interesting to this company's Filmlands, they know nothing about Danish companies, because that was a time where before there was so every company was quite local orientated, and Stockholm is actually quite far away from everything, so they didn't know any companies producing television in Denmark, but they knew this film, The Celebration, and they thought, wow, we really like
they could
that
be
film.
Our partner, yeah.
So maybe they should be our partner, so they make a contact, and at the same time I have talked to the new CEO, so this CEO called me and said, hey, now we have just got the call from this company. Would you go up to Stockholm to actually try to be part of that project and try to get it back on track? So I went up to Stockholm in 2080, and for 3 weeks I worked together with Hans Rosenfeld, where we actually somehow, in that process, we solved how we should make this. And after that, it took off, simply.
And how many writers were involved?
Yeah, well, it's me and Hans, and then we had Camilla Algren, and then later on we had some episode writers. So that was how it started. Mm-hmm.
Did you all sit? Was it sort of a writer's room type situation, or not really like that?
Yeah, we made it. Both at that time, both Hans and I was quite experienced writers, so we also like to write fast, not to sit and develop for a year in one room. That's for both of us. It was we didn't think about that. Yeah. So we took some kind of in the first season. We took some kind of 1 week, 2 weeks. The first actually 3 weeks working together, and then we split up and writing and sending text to each other, and then we met afterwards. We made some. Then we got Camilla on board, and then afterwards we worked 2 or 3 days intensively, maybe every month or second month, where we talked about, and then we split up, and was writing for ourselves, and that was actually a way when we also later should develop season 2 or 3. That was actually that we had some kind of concentrated workshops, 1 week of workshops, then split
and then
up,
go away,
and then go away, write for ourselves, and come back 1 month later, and have and when we started up, I can say we started up in a room with no windows. it was in the back lot of Filmland. So we had, so I think it was totally crazy to coming up in the summertime in Stockholm, where it was fantastic summer.
And then to go, not for you, no sunshine. Yeah.
And then go into a room with no windows and sit there and develop. It was really, as a, it was so claustrophobic. Yeah. I have never, and later on we got better and better.
You got better conditions. Offices.
So
I
the
hope.
Last, the two last seasons of the bridge, we developed at a some kind of a castle, okay. Where a private castle, the private cooks and living in big size as a it's 1600 years yeah. Old castle, and really with private cooks and into as a, it was the totally opposite of this
the tiny room
with no windows that we actually started up in.
And when you started, obviously you're writing in two different languages, but you know, a lot, most Danes can understand Swedish and vice versa. But other than the language difference, were there sort of cultural differences in the writing process or in working with, was SVT much different to work with than DR?
Yeah. That's well, that was part of the fun of it, because actually when the project started, it was made because there was a conflict between SVT in Sweden and DR in Denmark. Because of that time, there has been made 5 or 6 shows in Denmark, TV shows that have been starting with Taxa and Unit 1, that and the shows who was made later on, all was quite popular in Sweden and actually got some million viewers in Sweden and made this trend of Danish drama in Sweden. But the same thing didn't happen in Denmark with the Swedish television. It was not popular. They didn't make some show. They didn't make maybe Beck. Except okay. Beck was quite popular, but all the other shows that SVT made, none of them actually hit an audience in Denmark. So SVT was quite frustrated because of the popular of the Danish series in Sweden, they have to invest more money in Danish series that Danish radio had to invest in Swedish series. So there was some kind of a bad balance between investment. So actually SVT has gone into this show quite cynical, that we are going, they had never made a big show in Malmö, that's the third biggest town in Sweden, the southern part of Sweden, and Malmö is close to Copenhagen, and the bridge has just been built a couple of years before. So they wanted really to say, can we make a high concept where we can get some Danish money out to make to force the Danish radio to invest in what is on the paper was a co-production, but in reality it was a Swedish production. So that was some kind of conflict. And the fun thing is, in the writing room, in the development room, we the Danish radio really tried not to get into it.
You could change that in the writer's room.
Yeah, right? we used that. We used that as actually part of the drama, the tension that was between, that we had meeting with two different kind of co-production that actually had problems because the ones thought that the other one wanted to handcuff them to get into that.
Yeah.
And the Danish radio wasn't interested to go into to making the bridge. But we used that, you can say, real life conflict to also go in to say, we're going to make this. How can we use that in the conflict also of the series? And what we experience, what we used is that of course you know, but in Scandinavian nations and the Nordic nations, there's a lot of tension between each other. From the outside world, we look at it as a homogeneous area, but if you go into it, and for example, Denmark, Sweden, if you go 300 years back in time, we had the most bloody, messy wars that you can credible. The war between Denmark and Sweden in the 1600 actually killed third of the Danish population, and actually the Danes have a little, somehow they feel that the Swedes are this evil dominant big brother that we, now we like them of course, but there's some kind of historical anger and revenge. So there's only,
you
there's
play
really
with some of that in the scripts.
Yeah, there's only when we play in Denmark, play football, there's two times when we play football where it's more in that just football. It's when we play with Germany and when we play with Sweden. That's
the life. That's not
that's, that's more than just football. It's also about national pride and some kind of revenging what had happened earlier in history. But we used that, and we, when we was creating the characters, the main characters in the Brits, we used also I can say when we was working, we had so much fun. Maybe you can also see a little in the
you
show.
But I mean, I remember some parts of the show that would the joke about who had the better bread, or just like, we brought you the bread because our bread is better. There's, you know, just little things like that.
We use the cultural difference as a of kind of, can we, because at that time there has been made some co-production between Denmark and Sweden, but you could always see the purpose, that the money from the other, that okay, if you make a Danish show, you have to have this Swede into it, and you could see the check on his back actually from the co-production deal or somehow. But so we had, and when we should do this, and it's actually some kind of, we were forced to do it, we say we're going to go into one of the things, we say we want to make a real co-production. We are really going into the difference between Swedes and Danes. So we're really not just Danes and Swedes working together because of financing situation. Really, it's about that. Actually, we will use it in the story, and we'll go into the cultural differences we have, and use that as a big part of it, and to heighten the quality and make it important for us to do. And the two main characters, Sagan Rehn and Martin Rode, we made them in the early construction, we made them as clichés of how we look at each other. So Sagan Rehn, she was starting. We started her as some kind of how Danes look at Swedes as beautiful women, but cold and some kind of robotic and no humor and some kind you can't get near them, and the Danish character Martin Rode, we made him like how Swedes looked in Denmark as some sloppy, lazy who's like to hygge, like to have a cozy time, but really don't like to work, and is unpredictable and especially lazy, and so we used that as some kind of
beginning,
and then we got deeper into them and putting more layers to them, and also using ourselves in creating what we think was interesting, our own life at that time, and putting into the characters.
Yeah. And what were the main challenges, especially not just season one, you can sort of see it, you know, working as a whole, but then when you have multiple seasons, what became the challenges of writing then?
I think the first season, we used a lot of time creating the characters and the also the storyline, when we found out what should be the but really about the tone of it, how we should use these small stories that we found out that was part of the high concept, that we put into stories that you, when you see, you don't know where it's gonna hit the plot. Gonna hit the plot, and so it was creating all this, and actually the crime story came quite easy. And I would say that, just to say, it was really when we made the Brit season one, we thought it should be the only season, because it was made of this Swedes want to have some payback from Danes, money-wise, co-production-wise. So we saw it was always when we were talking with the co-production, it was always okay. We just have to make this. So we also put into all what we have ideas and and actually we had in a long in the storyline we actually killed Sagan O'Rain. So we had it as a part of the construction that one of the characters should be killed, and we was killing. And then when we it got greenlighted, we start producing. We saw maybe, and the main producer, the Bruisers from Nimbus, and talked to us. Said, is it a good day to kill one of the main characters? Can't we keep her alive? So if you remember seeing the last episode, she also got really. Shut down, but then suddenly she arises, and do her stuff because she's not so hurt by the shot in the stomach at all. Anyway, but actually, because we thought it was a joke, totally one off. Also, when we was editing and making it clear, we thought, and we started to work on other projects. Both Hans and I started developing series with TV2. Hans started to do some other stuff, and we just that was it. Good to meet you. Yeah. Have a nice life in Sweden. Bye bye. And then we went to actually, and then suddenly two things happened. The Utøya tragedy happened in Norway, and somehow in our story we had a reflection of that. Because we had the same kind of super, super killer who really are angry at society and make some spectacular actions and also made a manifest and communicate with the public with some kind of manifest. And it was really crazy for us to when Utøya happened that we somehow. In a as a some kind of had a parallel parallel things not totally the same and when it came out it was obvious that we could see wow we had some kind of hit something that we didn't know was important but was really important and that's really started also the international interest because of Utøya and we had a story that some kind of reflects what you can call Scandinavian darkness or anger or something that under these perfect societies we have in Scandinavian countries there's some rage there's some there's somebody who wants to be the new the knights of whatever and in a way we have reflected that so suddenly and we could feel it when we made we had a premiere and we could just feel in the cinema where we showed like a festival like this we have made something who's actually quite important
did the huge international success surprise you at all because I guess like Gertz was saying you probably made it for Denmark and Sweden primarily.
We had never ever as what we was in competition with, especially in Denmark, it was The Killing. We wanted to make a better show or to compete with the killing because The Killing was just made a couple of years earlier on, and it was really great. And Søren Sveistrup, the creator, is a good friend of mine, and we have also worked together as episode writers and in Taxa. When he also grew out of that this early period, and it was you could see okay this is something new, but we didn't say this is something new internationally. We never ever we thought. We are going to compete it on a local basis in a Scandinavian way, and we also thought about wow, it's quite interesting to make a Danish Scandinavian show that is in Denmark. You feel it Danish, and in Scandinavia and Sweden, you feel it in Swedish. And that was the first show that really that the local audience felt that this is.
They had ownership of
ownership of the characters.
That might
the
be
story.
The first and last to ever quite feel.
Because
that
that's really interesting. Because then the market deal from we are only 5.5 million in Denmark, but they are 10 point. Certainly, we had 15 million who felt that this was a big that was something that was important for them and felt that it were local. And then we had to develop in this when the success started off. We had to develop season two, and we had in the process of working with season one, we had no idea. As we had never thought about making a season two, so we was it was and we had to do it immediately, and it should come out after 2 years. So we had to start the process, and we started up. We had one idea. It was Hans. He wanted to have a ship sailing into the bridge as some kind of speculative start scene, and then there should be some kind of mystery about this ship, and we should build the story out of that. And then we had to start build the story out of that. And the main, you can say, main difficulty, you can see what when we has created series season one, we had used a lot of time creating the characters and the character line by lines and arcs and use that but when we was developing season two, we had these.
You already had that in
and it was really easy for us to say, okay, this is so that was an easy part of it, to have the character arcs of the main characters. But the difficult part of especially season two, but also later on season three or four, it was make the crime story original and fresh, and not something that was as a, something who was who had this big mastermind crime to it, that there's some kind of big mastermind crime that we see that was part of the formula. We had to have this, but it should be something totally different from the mastermind crime we had in season one. And we used a lot of time to try and try a lot of different kind of way before we find out, okay, this is going to be the new crime story. So that was and later on in season three and four, that was also the main. But then when we worked on season two, we know that if we make season two work, there's also going to be a season three.
So we started
in the process of making season two, we started just in our subconscious to think. So it was a little easier with season three, because then we had a catalog of ideas to start when we was finishing. And then there came some other problems in season three that we hadn't thought of.
Yeah, that was casting.
Yeah, that was our one of main characters wanted to have control of the series, and Kim Bodnia, who is we love. I personally, he's a great friend, but he was a little crazy, and he invented so much of himself in the character of Martin Rode in season one and two. So we should make a season three, he wanted to have control of the story simply, and then we said, oh, you can't have that. And he wanted to write it himself, and we had to say, okay, thanks, but no thanks. And we actually have to sack him and get a new actor to be a new part of it. And that was starting 4 months before we started shooting, so we had to do a rewrite of the first four episodes. But that was season three.
Okay, there's so much behind the scenes we don't know. We're running a little short on time, so I wanted to jump ahead and ask you, first of all, just the place of the writer in the Danish film industry. Do you feel like, or Danish TV industry as well, do you feel like the writer has a lot of power, of control over your destiny, of your career, what you want to get made? Does it, you know, because it sounds like 20 years ago it would be a writer for hire. But now do you feel like you could create a show and take it somewhere and get it off the ground?
I think that actually what happened when DR started up with new tradition was to have focus on the writers. And actually there was a lot of conflict with the directors who wanted to have control, both of Taxa. They wanted the director who created the visual looks, he wanted to have also control of the series, and DR had to sack him. And later on says, this is a writer's medium to make television series. If you are going to have strong television series, it's the writer's medium. And that started there. So there was a really a focus early on to make the main writer or the head writer or the creator, making him or her the creator, and also serving the episode writers to also join them and make them part of the process and part, but not just hired hands, but actually get them to really invest and also pay them good and good time to it, and that tradition start. And then later on, when they should make more shows, there was a tradition that was really strong in DR that they asked the writer, "What do you want to write?" Oh. And not giving, "Oh, we have this idea of we want this kind of show, or can you write this?" Blah, 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 blah. Now, as that, where it's more producer driven, there was really a tradition of what do you want to do. So a lot of also,
as and that's still happening, if you feel.
I think now it's going to change a little. It changed a bit in some ways. There's still an element of it, but it really, it's what happening in Denmark, like in all other countries, is that the stream service are really strong, and also going to making local originals. What I think is fantastic, but suddenly, for example, in Denmark, we now have 5 broadcasters making television series, and at that time, I think one of the main issues, and also one problem, is that every broadcaster wants to have their own identity and not make the same as the other one. So there's a great fear in all broadcasters to take the wrong decision of what kind of show, and also that they should actually manage what kind of show. So right now we are in a gray area.
Not just sort of take a great pitch because it might.
They are really afraid of not have their own identity. And in the shows, the order and pick up, and also think that maybe because they own or are part of the this station, this broadcaster, they also a little clever than everybody else, and they have this idea of what they think would be the next success, and I can see there's a tendency that they don't ask the writers so often as they did earlier on. What do you want to do? And so you have to operate in a field where you also had some producers and broadcasters who think they have make the idea of what they want. And yeah, I think you could also see some of the shows here that I think this big Greenlandic show with the boat, it's not a writer's vision. It's some kind of producers. How can we make a co-production? So that kind of production and company's decision, you have to operate it as a writer. But what I think is important for writers to make a good show, to make quality, is that if you have that situation and get onto. You have to really think, how can we make it personal? And that was actually also a thing that Hans Rosenfeld and I did with the Brits, was that it was some kind of a corny situation with the conflict between Danish radio, but it gave us an opportunity to make a show that actually we really, because the Danish radio, they had no, we have 3 or 4 meetings, they never cared what we did. And the Swedes, somehow, they was quite nice to us and said, "Oh, do what you want to do." So we when we was creating the bridge, we really created with a lot of totally free control, because that there was no expectation of it to be something big, and actually we could just do what we wanted to do. So we used that opportunity to really make a crime show that we thought would be fun to look at, as a really but then when we had the success and in season 2 all came and wanted to be part of that. Yeah. Then we had a lot of meetings with the broadcasters and commissioners who had really great ideas what should be part of season 2 and season 3, because then all want to be part of a success and also come with the right notes and have the right ideas, but we had, it was incredible making season one because we had so few meetings with
just writing.
And actually one thing was also interesting with season one of the Brits. It was the first series in Scandinavia who had some kind of patchwork financing because Sweden only wanted to pay so much and Denmark, then the Danish radio wanted to pay so little. They really, so the, we had to have financing, and then we get some financing for Norway and from SZDF, and we made some kind of patchwork financing. That and that was actually the first series who was financed like you do a lot of movies, cinema, and later on that's created a trend that you can get to how can you get money from a board.
I wish we could talk all day, but we're over time. I have a lot more questions. I'm sure the audience does, but I will tell them to please find you at the coffee break and ask your burning questions to Nikolaj. Because, yeah, I think it's this last ending note about, you know, the quality, the bringing yourself, your personality, your personal approach into it. It's great.
Yes, I would say one thing. I will, because I think it was really interesting to see all those trends. And there are things, there's a big trend, and somehow it also reflects in the shows right now. It's about the reality, and also how to use the reality in a in a way. But a part of that, some that you didn't mention, but I think is if you kick on the broad media side, there's a big crisis in journalism. Journalism, in classical journalism, you could say, investigating journalism, it has not the same, it has not the same financing that they had early on with the big papers and the big news corporations who really had money to have. And what you can see a tendency is that actually really investigating journalism has a future in television series that you mix them. I think a good example of that is both Our Boys, who's really, as it's really, it goes really into to tell a story that actually happened and go into all the layers of what happened in Israel at that and Palestine at that time, and so the Israelis somehow had started it, also with Fauda, who was also really journalism heavy, but also a series like Chernobyl, because behind Chernobyl, it's been made behind the book who actually investigated and found all these stories that was behind the Chernobyl accident, and all this what happened at the back scene. It's journalists who actually was digging that story out, and so there's a big lot of great stories where actually writers and fiction writers team up with investigating journalists and try to make this a new genre where actually you can make investigating journalism get in a big forum and really put it a new way. So there's a big possibilities.
True crime, true X.
But journalism as good investigative journalism, that's a key to a lot of fiction in the train with made in a high quality like the Chernobyl, because if they have played in a phony way or something, so the quality of Chernobyl combined with journalism. And I would just say one thing, a last thing. Now we are in Estonia, because Denmark, Estonia, we had some kind of a story, not just the flag who fell down, but also this fantastic and horrible bank crisis we had with the Danish bank who had a brand here in Estonia, in Tallinn, and where they was washing money white from Russia, especially in a big way that actually was the biggest financial scandal ever in Denmark, that the biggest bank, all the CEOs, all the leadership, just get up, and they're going to be a criminal investigation. And I would love to just to say something, because there has been some journalists who had been investigating that in Denmark and followed, but to make a TV series where you actually show that, but what happened in Estonia, the Estonia in the Estonia financial authorities and what happened actually in this bank from an Estonian perspective, that could you could make a co-production with Denmark, because that would be enlightening for Denmark, also putting our countries closer to each other. So that's a good co-production and opportunity.
So if you're an Estonian writer, find this man during the coffee break. You could be the co-writer of this series. Amazing. Thank you so much, Nikolaj. I wish we had longer time.